my focus today is these force platforms, or the use of force platform, but more so in the process of rehab, return to play, post return to play. But I want to set the scene a little bit in terms of the conventional use of force platform testing in performance profiling or injury risk screening. Today, the most common use of force platforms in elite sports is this holy grail of fatigue readiness monitoring on a weekly basis, bi-weekly, monthly basis. So I want to touch on that, but I think the background is important because this stuff has been around for decades. Force platforms have been around for decades, you know, at least 30, 40 years of use in of research papers in biomechanics labs and so forth. And the last, well, I'll show you some changes that I've gone through just in the last 15 years with force platform use. But certainly in the brackets, dual force platform, I think the key is an amazing revolutionary idea to go from a single to a double platform. Not really revolutionary, more evolutionary, but that's been one of the key things. And I do think that as far as performance profiling, fatigue readiness monitoring, the return to play, the rehab monitoring, the post return to play monitoring, not just because that's the focus of today, but I do think that's probably the most interesting area of application for force platform, for dual force platforms, and in a sense the one that's least widely applied or understood. So I think it's a great conversation to have. I remember, and it was the only time I ever met Alex Ferguson, coming down and looking at these force platforms and making a few jokes. To him, this was quite amusing looking thing. But 5 or 6 years later, they had an exercise physiology lab, which is one of the amazing things about Alex Ferguson, is that even though he didn't necessarily know or believe in it directly, he says in his autobiography that sports science is one of the major changes in professional soccer. So that potential to adapt and get the right people in, which he did. So 10 years later, in this left-hand corner picture, was this evolutionary application of putting two force platforms together. And this was at Arsenal, and we did pre-season testing there in 2012, and this was all fine. And it fitted into the general approach, the conventional approach, where you performance profile players. And I'd say in some cases the conventional approach, and I've been guilty of it, is you do all this testing and then it goes into someone's Excel spreadsheet, and that's where it goes. And maybe if someone's injured, your benchmark, it isn't necessarily applied. So as a younger sports scientist, I was into lots of testing. As an older sports scientist, I'm into minimum amount of testing, maximum amount of use of that data. And then once you can prove that you're using that data, then maybe let's add another test. But if you're not going to use, you know, the test data from a single activity, movement, jump or whatever it is, then you've got necessarily business in doing lots of them. But the exciting thing is 2014, because we started doing in-season monitoring. So that's where the conventional goes to the modern, i.e. that we don't wait 6 months or 9 months to retest someone if they're not injured. In other words, healthy players can be retested too. And probably at times where they are under more stress load than having just walked in after 6 weeks on the beach into first day of pre-season, where they all look very well biomechanically and neuromuscularly. So, And that approach, and why, and again, I feel a little bit sort of show-offy a little bit about this, because we didn't intend to do this. The Force Decks hat, the business hat, this was supposed to be a project to help us do research. And when I was at Man U 3, I think 2013 or 2014, we showed them this software that we were using to do the analysis. And they said, well, one of the sports scientists there said, I want that. We said it doesn't really exist as a thing yet. And we ended up doing it. And between 2014 and 2016, this is the, not completely exhaustive, but this is more or less the list of now who's using that system with just through word of mouth. So it's quite exciting that maybe I'm wrong, but we can't, all these guys can't be wrong, can they? Maybe. Thomas isn't wrong, so he's on the list as well. But what inspired it? Well, what inspired it really from that data, which we couldn't end up publishing. It changed that the original Manchester United data was supposed to be part of a PhD, and it couldn't be because they said initially they let me have the injury data and we could do this prospective injury study, and in the end they changed their mind. However, there was some interesting data that came out of it, and I'm presenting you some of that. It's not Man United data, obviously, but it's 15 years later. Even now, Ryan Giggs has retired, so there is none of those players still playing. But what I found interesting about this is we have a pre and post left and right for seven legs. Now, the eighth leg was not allowed to be tested on that day. It was a single leg jumps. So you have pre and post injury. We had pre-season data in early July, and we went back and we were looking at four players with these seven legs, so three of them both legs and one of them just the uninvolved side, and looking at a couple of parameters on the force platform in terms of neuromuscular performance. And what you can see here is that if you look in the right hand corner where you've got just these block graphs, the peak force values, which are generally achieved, the concentric part, the takeoff part, the propulsive part of that jump, on the mean had recovered to where they were prior to injury. And this was at return to play. This was more or less all of these players were about to return to play or had just returned to play. But what's interesting is that the eccentric RFD, or rate of force development, okay, their kind of braking capacity, braking force, was 25% mean over those seven legs. 25% and significant, even with only seven legs involved, pre and post, significantly lower, and in deficit relative to where they were prior to that injury. And you can see the individual leg data. Now, this meant that even the non-injured legs were also detrained in that eccentric rate of force development. And that really got me interested to say, well, yeah, there's no PhD anymore here, and we're going to have to do things a little quicker. Because the other thing, the other inspiration from that setting, from that that experience, was we did 80 players tested in about, I think, blocks of 2 hours between 9:30 or 10 a.m. and 12 noon. So first team one day, academy reserves, and no one was late for lunch, which is pretty important. It's very important. It's more important in Colombia than anywhere else. It's one of the only things that is actually always on time, midday. But even in Manchester, it's pretty important. But then I proudly returned this 85 players data around January of the following year, and I was wondering why they weren't that interested. So pre-season had passed, half the season had passed, and I've come back with this great, fantastic force platform information, but it took me that long. I had a full-time job as well, so it wasn't 6 months. It took me that long to process through Excel spreadsheets and algorithms to process the data that we collected. So I wasn't invited back the year after. That's maybe why they didn't want to give me the injury date, because they thought I wasn't being of any use. And I'll admit that it just took too long to give that turnaround. So that kind of inspired the software development, because I think it's very good to have good data, but unless it's timely, then you're really undermining the quality or the actionableness, if that's a word, of that data. So, you know, my question was, so if these things are so great, why are they not being used in the great Premier League, where everything is most advanced, supposedly? Expense, often not a barrier, but what people don't realise sometimes is that the sports medicine department have budgets like everyone else. They have to use that wisely. It's not like paying players where you you know, the roof is, the sky's the limit. So people don't want to spend money on something they don't think they're going to use or isn't useful. And so the time issue was, you know, getting this wonderful forced time data through spreadsheets and processing it. The other thing was there was a bit of a resistance to jumping. This was a two just quotes, and hopefully you don't get this so much in Canadian or American footballer, but this was an academy footballer saying, you know, all this testing, leave me alone, I'm a footballer, not an athlete. And the other one is, why am I jumping? I don't jump much in a match, right? So jumping is not the only thing you can do with platforms, but it's one of the most common tests that is done and that we'll talk about today around neuromuscular performance profiling. You know, why jump? What's the, you know, if I don't jump in the sport? Now, I think it's quite, I think that, you know, we're talking about a neuromuscular performance test. We're not talking really, in most cases, about actually just measuring jumping height. Okay, if you want to do that, then you've got, I think, the Just Jump round the corner and you can get jump height very easily. Why we're using a force platform and we're doing a jump is we want to understand neuromuscular characteristics, how force is produced, rather than just an output variable or a task output. And I like this because the English, the Team GB women's hockey, field hockey team, and think about field hockey, they jump very little, except when they win the gold medal, but which they did. And they jump every day. They were jumping once a day leading up to Rio and in Rio as part of neuromuscular monitoring. So again, it wasn't about how high they could jump. It was about having some indication of how they were responding to competition and training load. And at the English Institute of Sport, about 30 of 36 sports use force platforms in some way in performance profiling, fatigue monitoring, and so forth. And some that, you know, I wouldn't necessarily expect hockey, yes, because there's a big eccentric component, but swimming also used platforms and used that up to Rio, up to and including Rio. So, you know, what we're really talking about is here's a tool in the toolbox on that functional end of the continuum. It doesn't say I like isokinetic dynamometry, you know, for eccentric hamstring testing. I know we've got now the Nordboard and versions of that, but I do like isokinetics, and I think there's a role for them. But often, the thing in red, I test that are simple and rapid, but obviously have to give you relevant data in the context of sports is really important. Not necessarily because you might have volume of athletes to test. In some cases it is, but in some cases it's just being able to do more frequent testing in rehab that really helps you define if you're going in the right direction. And if that takes too long to do those tests, then it's a barrier. So we've got our... Please do, yeah. I'm supposed to, this is not town hall enough. I'm supposed to be a bit more interactive. Sorry. I should stop talking for a
minute. When you talk about the women's field hockey team,
yeah.
You said they're testing every day for competition. Is that used in more of a therapy context or more of a coaching strategy?
It was used more as a marker of the, not so much the jump height, but some of the characteristics in the jump in the force time profile. How well have they recovered from the previous match, stroke? Is there a trend towards a decrease in some of those variables? So it's more of a readiness fatigue tool. If asymmetries increase, then it's maybe a therapy element. But in that sense, it was neither. They weren't looking for training adaptations as such, but looking at markers of potential overloading or, yeah. So the classic diagnostics there, Bosco, who's the godfather of those sort of tests. But I think also, when I say other things you can do, and because there is also still a resistance sometimes to the impact loading associated with jumping in heavier athletes as a means to monitor regularly neuromuscular performance, you've got some of these nice isometric tests. The mid-thigh pull on the far left-hand side is a classic strength test. The next one along is a posterior chain test, bilateral. There's a unilateral version of that. inverted commas hamstring. Obviously, it's not purely hamstring, but it's used as a fatigue monitoring tool quite a lot in team sports, in rugby and in soccer. And then there's a shoulder test. These are all sort of 3 second maximal effort isometrics. The beauty, I guess, of that over a handheld is that you're getting, again, not just peak values, but how you got there, i.e. the rate of force development, what's happened after 100 milliseconds, how rapidly can they activate those fibers. So again, it's not just jumping. But finally, if we just emphasize those in the red, but remind ourselves that performance profiling is a key application, or asymmetry profiling is a key application of force platform testing. I'm not going to talk very much about the concept of asymmetries as a primary risk factor, mainly because there isn't really that much evidence around that. Not that it isn't the case. There is some data from interlimb asymmetries of strength as being a risk factor, but I think the focus is more on, once you've got an injury, secondary prevention here, and also monitoring the adequacy and the progression of that rehab and stroke return to play. And then the third one is that sort of very in fashion fatigue readiness monitoring. But again, that kind of leads back into maybe the injury risk setting. And so this is an example at one soccer club where match day plus two, you have a collection of monitoring components, wellness, adductor squeeze, and then here you have in the background you have a counter movement jump, and you see someone lying back and they're doing a hamstring bridge as well, 3 seconds to get that snapshot essentially of neuromuscular profile. So the point being that the response to load is probably the factor which keeps the predictive value of asymmetries and of pre-season screening down. Because if a player can maintain an asymmetry as compared to ones we found, and this is on a very small scale and it's sort of internal study, that the players that become either a lot more asymmetrical or less asymmetrical, in other words, any large percentage point movement in symmetry, are the ones that are more susceptible. So if you're asymmetrical but you maintain it, that's a healthy asymmetry. That's an asymmetry that you cope with. So what we want to see is, what is the response of these variables in season to load? And we need these kind of snapshot tools. And many of you might be familiar with Tim Gabbett's work around acute-chronic ratios in terms of workload, and how it's not what you did in that competition, but it's what you did the 3 weeks prior to that that determines whether that competition load is excessive or risky or not. In other words, if there wasn't enough training leading up to that high level of intensity, that's a risk factor. But if you were prepared for it by having adequate intensity, then it's not risky. So what's the missing piece, in a sense, is having this, and this is an editorial in BJSM from Tim Gabbett, highlighting the fact that it needs to be more emphasis. And he's his papers are all on GPS and GPS as a predictor of injury and so forth. But you need more indicators of what is the response to that workload, because it changes. It's different between individuals, and it's different between this within an individual over time. When that starts to change, that could be something relevant to that an indicator of vulnerability or increased risk. Now, this is Championship is the division below the Premier League. So these are elite soccer players. MD minus one is match day minus, is the day before a match. MD plus two is the 2 days post. So you're talking about jump testing being performed 1 day prior and 2 days post match. FTCT is a variable I'll talk about in a bit. It doesn't really matter what variable it is. It's a variable, it's a bilateral variable within the counter movement jump. And what you can see is that the mean data for this was 12 players who played at least 80 minutes, 0.14%. So either these guys had the competition actually had no impact on fatigue, didn't cause any fatigue, or they're very good at recovery, because less than 1% or less than 0.5%. That's the mean data, and this is the individual data. And what I've got here is four players in the red who show several standard deviations from the normal variability in that variable. Lots of variables are variables. Significant decreases in that indicator, suggesting that yes, they either didn't recover from that competition or it was extremely fatiguing. You've got the orange ones who are almost carbon and then completely stable, and then a couple of green ones who actually that competition appears to have been a training stimulus. So looking at the mean, as we all need to in research papers, is obviously useful, but you're actually dealing with individuals, and that this is supposedly a homogenous group of elite soccer players. Well, actually, they're not homogenous in the way they respond. And this, I guess, would be a lot more variable in a sport like American football or Canadian football, where there really are, you know, major differences in the body type. But this is, so if we come back to the concept of, well, where did this picture come from? This picture around a contact mat is from, I think, an article in the paper several years ago about the Omega Wave, which was an approach to combine heart rate variability, jumps, and various things to give you an orange, red, or green score around readiness. And they used flight time, and which can be used to estimate jump height. And jump height became popular as a potential fatigue monitoring tool. What I hopefully show you is that is the tip of the iceberg, meaning that it's quite important, but there's a lot going on under that you'll miss if all you look at is the jump height, at least in terms of that fatigue, development of fatigue, and also rehabilitation and recovery from injury. So what are we getting? We're essentially getting the how. With the force platform, the force time approach, you're getting how was the jump performed, meaning what is some biomechanical neuromuscular information around the eccentric phase, the concentric phase, and the landing phase. And that's assuming we're talking about a counter movement jump, obviously. If it's a squat jump, there is no eccentric phase. But I'll come to why the emphasis is on the CMJ a little bit later. And then if you have two platforms, then suddenly you double your intelligence, or you triple it, you suddenly have total performance left, right, and then the asymmetries thereof. Simultaneously, and getting back to that point, I'm not asking an athlete to do a second test or three jumps each side to get asymmetry. I've got one test, I'm doing three trials or five trials, and I'm getting the classic performance variables plus the asymmetries at the same time. So less testing, more data under that principle. So this is a classic bilateral force time profile. And what you're seeing, can you see the cursor? Does that come through? Loading phase. And here, to my embarrassment, when I first started with this, I thought this was the start of the concentric phase when it goes up. But I found out after early in 2000, luckily quite early, that in fact all you're seeing here is an increase in force, but you're still, this eccentric phase continues up until
it's not showing up on the screen.
What's going on physically is I'm still going down up until that point. Okay, so the eccentric phase, this is not the beginning of the eccentric phase. This is the beginning of force production within the eccentric phase. The concentric phase begins out here. So what we've got is an eccentric phase that has an unloading part, a loading part, and as we'll see in a moment, from this point onwards, a deceleration phase. Okay, so what happens from this point here is that I'm still going down towards the deepest position, but I'm decelerating. So the eccentric control now is key. This is the brakes, basically. So sometimes we'll look at the eccentric phase as a whole, and sometimes we'll want to break it down into that deceleration, that braking phase, to understand how well a force is controlled once you've generated velocity going in one direction. If we can imagine that for injury risk, there's an obvious need for control for changes of direction, so performance, it's important as well, and possibly for robustness, which we'll come to in a sec. I'll go back.
When you're tracking this, as far as synchrony goes, are you more concerned with what center of gravity is or with the force distribution between the legs?
Force distribution, because you can't really, without triaxial platforms, with just vertical platforms, you're struggling to really know where the center of gravity, the center of gravity is, but you know what, you can be definitive about the force distribution.
Yes, you're only indirectly vertical.
This is, yeah, in these sides. I mean, if you've got the triaxial and the kinematics, you can resolve that as well. So this is kind of, this is the simple version of force platforms in a way, kind of thing. But yeah, good point. You could look at that if you had that capability. So that's the flight time, and you've got some other characteristics. Now, what's really important is, in terms of, and in fact, a Canadian, or no, he's from Bolton, but he's studied in Canada under Ben Spora in Vancouver, Rob Gathercole, who's done a lot of work looking at this length of this concentric, of this contraction phase as an indicator of fatigue. So, and then we've got the peak landing area right on the right hand side, peak landing forces, and a variable called flight contraction time. And then we've got some RFDs, and I say some RFDs, there's some various ways of calculating that. Now, if I just stop for a second here and also check that I'm not going over time, but I think it's appropriate, can you see that now, to just show a test, and because I think we spoke about this a little bit earlier, just with starting that, you know, in some cases, we're talking about all this, I've said it's now so easy and you just do this and everyone can get the data, but it still looks like there's a lot of information and how does this thing fit together. So I just want to show briefly, and we'll come back to it and look at some other tests and you guys can run tests, but just to show you what we're talking about in a live situation, what kind of data comes out. So you zero, this is your so-called calibration to zero, and then I'm going to try and test myself, because there we go, it can be done. So where are we? Yeah, so we've got green and yellow is left and right, red is total forces, and I'll just do the classic three counter movement jumps. And you can see that characteristic profile. Okay. Right, so they've been identified as counter movement jumps, which is what they are. We'll do an analysis. We've got some offset that's been applied. And you've got some bilateral outputs here. Peak power, eccentric duration, flight contraction time, and then some asymmetries. So if we go to that raw data view, these are those phases that I talked about. So you've got the unloading part of the eccentric, you've got the start of the deceleration phase, the start of the concentric phase. This small area is concentric, it takes a lot less time than the eccentric, the flight, and then the landing. And you can see where those asymmetries are. And actually, this is a good example. I mean, I didn't deliberately do this, but you can see, for example, in the concentric phase, that I've got an asymmetry one direction at the start, when probably the early phase being more hip dominant, and then it goes the other way at the other end as I'm going to knee and ankle. And that's not uncommon to have those kind of variability within the phase, and hence why sometimes another Canadian, and a real Canadian this time, Matt Jordan, has looked at, for example, splitting the concentric into 50%, first 50% time-wise and so forth, because you may be getting different dominance of different joints by doing that. So I'm going to, any comments, any further things while I just go forward?
Is that something you would flag in a player, or like, what's the threshold for significance?
This is the million. What in terms of asymmetries?
Yeah, well, right. Like, I don't need a magic answer. Like, what in your
yeah.
Be a red flag or a yellow flag? Or?
Well, what I will do, what I will always do with those with asymmetries is to take the group and do a mean, and then do a half to one standard deviation, then one and above, and half to one as an orange flag and one and above as a red, and plus you see the percentage and do it as an absolute. Now in the overall, in the Premiership teams that I've worked with, the overall mean concentric force is between 6 to 8%. Right, so now the problem with that a little bit is that when we start to look at injury histories, you find guys with foot injuries, knee, ankles, and when you look at those players, they tend to have larger asymmetry. They're pulling the whole mean across. So what we call healthy is the guys that turn up in pre-season and that are allowed to compete, but they've got residuals. So that's hence why I'm a bit more conservative, say half to one standard deviation from an already motley crew of guys with histories is orange. But do we have the data? Do we have the evidence? I mean, the best way to do this is the sort of clinical prospective study with an ROC curve, where you say what is the actual odds rate? You know, what is the cut point? We don't have that for force platform data at this point. So therefore, I would look at it as those ones in the red zone are ones to watch, and you also take them in context, because sometimes you've got asymmetries that, and there's no injury, and you might think, well, this is a risk factor, whereas in other cases they've come out of 6 months post ankle and this is a residual, so you'd probably deal with it in a slightly different way as well, which is I'm not dodging the answer, but that's kind of where we are, to be honest. I don't think we have, I think, so you want to watch the asymmetries is one thing, you know, you want to look at the ones with the high levels. And the other thing I'm going to talk about is variability, because it's a really difficult thing. When you look at the mean asymmetry across 3 or 5 trials, right, you can have someone that's got a mean asymmetry of 3% to the right. That's made up of 10% to the left first trial, 15% to the right, back and forth. You've got guys that are, trial by trial, they go in different directions and they end up with 3%. And then you've got someone that's 3% to the right because they've been 1, 2, 5, 6 always on the same side. But the number will be the same. And I think what we're missing is a way to characterize variability in asymmetry across trials and in general, because what I'll show you, we've got some ACL data, really interesting, where the injured side was almost no variability in force output, and the healthy side was highly variable. So again, percentages can sometimes lie, because it doesn't tell you where the change is as well. So I think, you know, there's a lot more kind of digging to be done on this. And it's population specific. Now, if we now go to post-injury, then it becomes a little bit more clear, because this is a post-ACL elite wrestler, actually, who had to compete in a week. They did the testing, they'd already booked them to compete. The testing was kind of, let's just have a look. Oh, we don't want to see that. So you can see here, some asymmetries, right, even without any deep calculation. So what we tend to do, I'm going to show you 5 asymmetries, but I think that the key ones that I would look at, and I'll show you some data on that from the ACL the group. This is a single. I've got a study with 23 players. So this is the deceleration RFD asymmetry. So what it is looking at the asymmetry in the rate of force development at the point that I'm still going into I'm still in the eccentric phase, but I've started slowing down. So the eccentric force production is starting to do its job, and my velocity in the down direction is decreasing up until the point where here I stop, or I exchange into the concentric phase. So, and you can see here, for example, there isn't a lot of asymmetry in this first bit, but as they start to break, that's when the uninvolved side is exerting a lot more force, a lot more rapidly than the involved side. And then we've got force at zero velocity, which is at the eccentric concentric exchange. This is the whole concentric phase. So when you hear mean concentric force or impulse over the concentric phase, it's essentially covering this whole concentric area. And again, within that, there is an early hip, knee, and then ankle dominant phase. So, you know, you could split that down further, but the common thing is just to take an overall asymmetry. Now, what's interesting here is that, you know, that if people have looked at the isokinetic papers around provocation with a sort of 30 degrees per second eccentric load, this is the sort of horseshoe you see at the point of peak force where there's an inhibitory reduction in force. We've seen that sometimes. I mean, it's not only that there's a difference in force, I mean that you can just see it's not very steady in terms of force production. But again, that's something you kind of characterize by looking at it, but the mean values you can get. This is something that Matt Jordan looked at, was the second phase concentric impulse. Peak landing force asymmetries, which some people will say, you know, this is eccentric. Well, it has an eccentric component, but and this isn't too bad. I mean, the peak landing force, I don't have the scale on here, but I think in this instance, you know, they're sort of more or less double the takeoff. But I was at a meeting where they were showing some volleyball players, and they were doing 11,000 newtons on landing from a CMJ. So it was, you know, 6, 7, 8 times body mass. So it's not just eccentric, it's not just muscular control, it's stiffness, it's technique. There's a lot of factors going on in that, what contribute to that peak landing force. And I've just added these, you know, you see things like a late start of movement on the involved side. You can look at concentric subphases, you can look at the rate of force development, how quickly is force developed in that landing phase, which we'll come back to. So this is 23 pro soccer players after ACL reconstruction. Majority of these were patellar tendon, and all except one unilateral ACLs. And this is the mean values in those three, you know, just keeping it simple and saying, let's look at one eccentric asymmetry, the RFD, eccentric deceleration RFD, let's look at one concentric, and let's look at the landing, the peak landing. I guess the good thing about this study, it's all soccer players who are already asymmetrical, so it's slightly different than Matt Jordan's work. We had the skiers. The healthy ones were almost symmetrical, which is very different from team sports. These guys, none of them were completely returned to place. So these were obviously cleared to jump, but they were at different stages. So it's not all at the same stage of ACL rehab. So that's something else to sort of note about that. But I think what's interesting, and we talked about sort of refining rehab or how this may help in decision making, is this is the mean, and this is the 23 individual players. So ordered by degree of asymmetry. So the ones from 16 up, so you've got what, 4, 7 players out of 23. that were less than the mean for elite footballers in terms of concentric asymmetry. You know, all of these wouldn't be sort of highlighted because they're actually below average. You've got this group up here that are clearly high level of concentric asymmetry, but maybe we need to be looking at some other characteristics, because, you know, maybe we're very good at focusing on reducing concentric asymmetries, force production asymmetries. And a couple of key things here. It doesn't mean that always peak landing, I mean, this got no asymmetry at all on peak landing, but there's no correlation between any of these three. In other words, the ones that maybe, you know, on occasion you've got high levels here, but you've got player six, very low peak landing force asymmetry, high concentric mean, high eccentric. You've got player eight, low eccentric RFD asymmetry, relatively high concentric, and so forth. No correlation. So we don't, what can we conclude from that? Well, one, that the work that is being done or the condition of the athlete in force production doesn't necessarily represent how they're capable of coping with load acceptance, and I call this load acceptance rather than eccentric capability, because it's more than just, you're dealing with six times body mass. That's not just an eccentric contraction, that's a lot more. So do we know whether our programs are getting to these two? We're probably quite good at knowing if they get into these, because we've got lots of ways of measuring production. We can do hops, we can do vertical jumps, we can do isometric strength tests, but we don't really know so much about how we're necessarily getting to these. So now this was the variability, and we're just starting to analyze this. So these were just randomly the first five of those players that we looked at. And what this is so the injured limb force production, concentric mean force production, coefficient of variation or variability across the five trials that they all did. Force production, injured limb and healthy limb. Doesn't matter whether it's left or right. Injured limb, if you look at down, except for this one, you know, they're all extremely or very low variability. Healthy limb, much more variable variability, much higher variability in the same. So this is row by row is athletes. So, you know, while the injured limb is 1.2, the healthy limb of that same player is 3.6% variability across those five trials. That's a pattern that we see in those injured guys. So we're now not looking at percentage asymmetry in calculating that, because that would mask it, or it would tell you just something. Oh well, it's variable, but where is it variable? Actually, it seems to be variable in that healthy side. My question is is the healthy limb variable because the injured limb isn't variable, and the healthy limb has to just cope with whatever comes out because it's an open chain, or the other way around? I don't know if it's anyone got any thoughts on whether it's the chicken or the egg. But well, not in this group, unfortunately. And I think this is the thing, you know, we tend to do lots and lots of data with the bilateral CMJ, because as well in rehab, you know, you can almost, that you're going to do that much earlier than say a single leg. And there's a lot more technique involved in doing a single leg test. We've got a few teams where they've also done single legs. So I think, you know, talking to that point, it's really interesting to see that those asymmetries bilaterally don't always correlate with the asymmetries in single, and whether that tells you in itself something about the origin of that asymmetry. Because I think the single leg asymmetry is a lot to do with morphological or the muscle mass, whereas what you're seeing when you've got the bilateral condition is that the nervous system can choose what it wants to select. You know, when you go onto single leg, that's it. So all you can do is compensate through joints. You can't compensate through limbs. So More questions, some answers and more questions, unfortunately. Any other thoughts on anyone done look too much in variability on?
Is it more of a coordination thing, if reintegrating the injured limb back into a functioning system, or is it truly when you say single limb versus double limb, you don't find that you see that asymmetry as present when you're doing single limb work? It's less complicated than a double limb, you have double the coordination to do?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think certainly there's, it's almost saying it's not the same. There's more coordination and balance requirements in that single leg test as well. But again, the problem is that most of this rehab data that I've looked at, we don't have. See, what I'd like to see is, every 2 weeks CMJ and single leg, and see, do they parallel and those sort of things. But unfortunately, at the moment, we don't have that because people, and there's some that just do single leg. They think, all they want to do is single leg. They start later, but they just do single leg. Please, could you do CM bilateral? And and then they do bilateral and say, now you're asking me to do single leg again. So it needs, I think it will reveal something. But I think that possibly, because we always have this thing with asymmetries, was that a cause, with someone that's injured, if you don't know where they started, was that a cause? Or is it just a result of injury? I think that we don't even know. Is the variability, was this part of the reason for the injury? Is lack of variability in force production in an open chain activity where you should have lots of options, is that a risk factor? And should we be monitoring variability of parameters? I avoided the term using variability of variables because it starts getting variability in parameters. And if someone becomes less variable, is that saying they've got fewer options because they've got overuse or they've, so I just would question that. We need to look at that as a variability, as a variable, as a possible indicator. So I want to go from that to a case study to show, I said, you see at that overall view, there's no correlation between these three phases. But this is an example of how that can play out of these case studies, so it doesn't prove what's about to happen. But this is rehab time. The blue is rehab one, was first clearance for jumping. And the red is about 2 months later, and at that time point this player was doing on pitch training but hadn't returned to play fully. Now this is Viper stat sports data, high metabolic load, distance. I mean, the key is that this player 5, distance covered, speed, volume of speed intensity work, HMLD is higher than most of the other players, so their movement on the pitch in a training session doesn't tell you, this guy can't produce work on the pitch. They've got an increase in jump height between those two time points. They've got a decrease in concentric force asymmetry between those time points. And this is the landing force asymmetries at rehab one and at rehab two. So it's actually worsened. What's happened? Increased jump height, increased total peak landing force. So they've got another 1300 newtons, a third of the additional load to cope with from landing from 20, just under 20 to nearly 30 centimeters. And so what you've got is an increasing level of asymmetry. I'll show you the individual left and right for a cartilage injury, which is quite similar. But one of the reasons that we went back and looked at this is 6 weeks later was a contralateral ACL. Now again, that is absolutely not proof that landing force asymmetries cause contralateral ligament injuries. But I think the question is, if this is a model for how avoidance strategies or a model for revealing avoidance strategies, if an athlete is on pitch and they've got the opportunity to also repeatedly avoid loading the previously involved side, what are the implications for the healthy side? I think there has to be some just from a tissue loading perspective. And particularly if we think about it, it's not just jumping, but decelerations, changing the right direction, which have a lot of, a high degree of loading. So to show you in a cartilage example, so this was an ACL, this is again, see a similar thing. Now time one, first clearance for jump test, time two, 5 to 6 weeks later. Again, what are we seeing? Increase in peak landing force asymmetry. So, and again, increase in jump height between those two time points. So the concentric power production, impulse, force production is developing nicely through that rehab. Peak landing force increases, and here you can see really clearly why the asymmetry increases. So between those two time points, the uninvolved side has increased its loading, its absolute loading on landing. Involved side almost flatlined. So as a result, the asymmetry is increased. In fact, it's not got worse, it's just got worse relative to the fact that the other side is taking all the load. And again, these players are always being told, we're testing your jump height, so they're not thinking about landing. So there's a sort of suggestion that this is a feed forward, this is a spinal level, this is a co-contraction, pre-landing co-contraction or tissue issue, that it's not because they're thinking about offloading that side. There's a really interesting work out of this group in Ireland, which I think Jay Hurtle is also at university, is not Ireland, he's from University of Virginia, around post-ankle injury. So, you know, the major body of work around force platforms has been ACL, ACL, ACL. I've shown you an example of a cartilage injury. This is ankle sprain, and this was a paper that showed with the drop jump, which is, you know, again, a test that's been used or where landing forces are typically looked at, and from following on from Hewitt and Greg Meyer's work, you've got two landings in a drop jump. You've got the first one off the box, and then you've got the second one following the vertical jump. And what they showed was that the landing rate of force development was significantly lower in the side with the prior ankle injury. In other words, again, there's a redistribution of, in this case, not total force, but rate of loading to the uninvolved side. But they had cameras as well, so they were able to look at kinematics and determine that what was happening is an increased loading on the hip, on the ipsilateral and the contralateral side. So talking to that point, if you're going to get rid of load, where is it going? It's got to go to another limb, or it's got to go to another joint. And again, their conclusion, you're increasing exposure to load in that joint. So